Hello. Hi everyone, my name is Tao. I'm a machine learning machine learning scientist at Reverie Labs. This is my first RDKit UGM conference, so I'm both nervous and excited to talk to you guys. First of all, I'd like to say I have been enjoying all the talks today by all the speakers. Everything everyone's been doing is very interesting and I've been learning a lot, which is awesome. Just a little bit about Reverie Labs. We're stuck in Boston, and we work on an ACE inhibitor, small molecule drug discovery. And we basically do whatever we can to try to accelerate this process. This includes machine learning, computational chemistry, algorithms for chemistry to help scale and automate a lot of workflows. And we have a lot of collaboration between both computer scientists, biologists, chemists, medicinal chemists, basically everyone. A little bit about me. In college, I was mainly a computer scientist, and I worked at various software companies, Facebook, NVIDIA, Google, and most of my work has been mainly in algorithms and machine learning and math, which is basically to show that my chemistry is very limited. And I've basically been picking up through my work. So at Reverie Labs, basically my experience has been working in optimization problems. So this includes both modeling and software optimization, as well as machine learning on molecules, fingerprints, graph-based, convolutional-based, as well as for living thinking and square function utilities. And as well as these algorithms for chemistry, somewhat related to what John Mayfield presented yesterday about using RDKit fingerprints to speed up substructure research is an example of that. Today, I will also be talking about an algorithm. Basically, it's retrosynthesis for chemistry. And this whole set of tools basically allows us to automate a bunch of stuff that chemists might take a really long time to do and allows them to speed up the workflow. Great. So an outline for today's talk, I will warn you guys, the final technical implementation isn't that intense. So you won't get too much out of that, but I hope that the journey through problem solving and the motivation for how we do things is that you guys will enjoy the fun journey that I have. So first, I'll talk about the motivation for why we wanted a retrosynthesis algorithm in-house. And then to implement this retrosynthesis algorithm, we had to use reaction smarts, but there's several shortcomings of reaction smarts. So I will address those and address how we overcome the shortcomings with our built-in in-house smart wrapper. And then I will talk about some additional use cases of the smart wrapper and additional ways you can wrap smarts to have it be suitable for other applications. So why do we want a retrosynthesis algorithm? Well, as a company, we create novel small molecule kinase inhibitors. So they're only meaningful if we can synthesize them. So we need to be able to create them. And that means, from these generative models that we use, we only want to look at the ones that we can measure. And the way we do that is through some resistance. But some of the tools that's available, you basically have to, input your molecule and then it will, do their retrosynthesis algorithm and determine if you can make it or not. But unfortunately, you can't scale this to, hundreds of thousands, millions of compounds that easily, unless you want to feed all your molecules into some web-based.
Can I stop you for a second?
Yeah.
Can you move in front of
me? Oh, sorry. Yes. Okay. It's a decoy. Great. So this is what the basic retrosynthesis algorithm looks like. And rather than like a machine learning, type of algorithm, We decided to go with an algorithm that's not black box. So basically, we can be confident that whatever you have can be debuggable entirely. And so the basic outline is, you have a list of building blocks and you have a list of reactions, and you want to determine if you can make a compound. The algorithm is a depth first search algorithm. So it's recursive in nature. And basically, you first determine if it's in the building blocks. And if it is, return true, great, you can obviously make it. Otherwise, you get a list of possible reactions that can treat this compound. And then for each of these reactions, we basically check, can we synthesize all the reactants that can that creates this compound? And then if we can make everything in this reactant list, then we return true. If not, and we exhausted all the reactions possible, then we can't make it because there's no reaction that has all possible reactants creating the compound. This is like a very short pseudocode, and there's some stuff missing, including like cycle detection, caching, and all that stuff, but this is basically more or less the general outline. So here comes the tricky part, which is this get possible reactions, that all the reactions are coming. How can we actually implement this? This is not that easy. So first we want to check out what this get possible reactions look like. And we want the input to be a compound that we make. And the output is going to be a list of reactions that can produce this compound. And each reaction should have some information based on what sort of reactants are participating in this reaction. And each reaction should contain miscellaneous information about the reaction. This can include like yield or reagents or things like that, whatever the chemists are interested in. And so you might be wondering, why can't we just use RDK SMARTs? I looked into this as well, and the cookbook is very comprehensive, and this is one of the examples of the reaction SMARTs. For those of you who are familiar with it, you basically have SMART as the reactants, and then you have these two arrow signs and the SMARTs as the top. And there's an example up there. And the issue is that, this is an 80% solution. So it's most of the way there, but there's still a 20% part where things start failing. And it becomes, kind of not, you can't use it to do it on like hundreds of compounds, because then, you'll have a lot of errors. And the reason is because SMARTs is hard. If you look at the early kit mailing list, there's always questions about, the SMARTs didn't work, or, I had some trouble matching this with some compounds. Why isn't this working? And that's definitely a problem I faced as well when working with them. So our approach to this is, rather than making a fully correct SMARTs, try to make it marginally better and to make it more useful for most of the cases. So first we want to identify what parts of the SMARTs are painful to use, and then ways to address it. So why are SMARTs particularly difficult? One, they're hard to visualize. If you ever looked at a SMARTs, they can be pretty messy, and it's hard to see what it actually means. And two and three are basically very related. They're basically hard to specify and hard to debug. For the first issue, there's some tools that can be used to address this. They need to visualize the SMARTs. I think from previous presentations also have shown this. For the second two points, I'll illustrate them through an example. And once again, I'm not a chemist, so maybe this example doesn't really make sense. But if we want a SMART to identify some sort of nitrogen linker that links like two parts of a molecule, that's and it's only monetized. Maybe you have some image of what that looks like. And as a naive first attempt, you can do something like CNC. Nitrogen bonded to two carbons. And we have our, we basically look at some hits and some misses. And we can immediately see that, you know, the hits are not what we want. It's not a nitrogen linking two parts of the molecule. And so, you know, this is part of the reason why debugging is so hard, is because, you know, you don't really know why CNC is wrong or why it's right. So you have to like go through a list of hits and a list of misses to make sure that it kind of matches your intuition. And this whole cycle is, you know, time consuming and difficult. So as a second try, you can be like, all right, I don't want this nitrogen to be part of the ring. So you say, okay, it's in zero ring. And then we look at the hits and we look at the misses. And we start to see, okay, the first one looks fine, the second one looks fine. Third one, oh, what's wrong here? Oh, this nitrogen is, you know, connecting three parts of the molecule instead of two parts. So we can say, okay, we just want the nitrogen to have two bonds. And then we start to look at the hits, they look great. We start to look at the misses, and then we see, oh, this, we kind of missed this molecule, this third molecule. And why is that? Well, the carbon we specified is aliphatic, and we want them to hit both aliphatic and aromatic. So, final attempt, we get something that kind of matches the intuition that we were originally looking for. So this whole process is kind of difficult to make sure that you get. And then, why are reaction smarts difficult? For one, instead of writing one correct smarts, now you need to write correct smarts for the reactants and the product. So you're debugging lots of smarts. You need to make sure that the atom indices are aligned. So you mix up the atom mapping at time. The other thing is that wild cards don't match hydrogens, which can be an issue. I'll explain more on that. And they're generally not written to be reversible, which is an issue because we're doing retrosynthesis, so we're going backwards. So we would like them to be reversible. So for the first two, I basically addressed them. The aligning the indices is basically something that you just have to make sure of. There's no real easy way. For the wild cards not matching hydrogens, just want to illustrate an example. This is an example reaction. Where you have like two R groups, and then they undergo some reaction and mix this product. So as a first attempt, you can write something, oh, R group, we just have it as a wild star, an asterisk one, and asterisk two, and then they just get mapped. Unfortunately, this doesn't capture hydrogens. You can't have a hydrogen as a matching a wild card. So what we do instead is we just attach everything to the carbon. And say, okay, we just have carbon, identifies one, and then we just add it to the carbon. And this works and allows you to capture a hydrogen. Okay, so now we've addressed that. So instead of using the wild cards, we use map atoms to allow for hydrogens. And then for the last one, reversibility, you know, generally they're not reversible. You know, here's one example. We have a reaction, and then you know, reversing it is basically bringing the products, the reactant, and then the reactant to the product. We see that, you know, this second reaction doesn't really make sense. You can manage like sulfur here or some other halogen, and you know, it won't become this. And so there's some ways around it. You can basically, you know, if you have commas and specifications, you can carry them over. If you have different like oxygens or nitrogen, you can split them up into multiple reactions. If you have specifications on the atoms, like it can't be a carbon connected to a nitrogen, you can specify that using a the recursive smarts and then carry that over to the products. So there's ways to go around it, but it definitely makes it more difficult. And lastly, I wanted to go through an example of why these fraction smarts are hard to specify. And this is basically similar to why smarts are hard to specify. So if we want to write a reaction for this reaction, then ideally we could write something that kind of matches what we see. We have carbon connected to two oxygens, and then it gets connected like that. But the issue, like we saw in why smarts are hard, is that you get a lot of wrong matches. So in terms of the first smarts, it wrongly matches this compound, which has an extra carbon attached to it. And then for the product, this product wrongly matches this compound, which you can't reverse, because if you reverse it, you basically have the R1 and R3 groups connecting, which don't get connected, which are not part of the same compound in the reactants. So basically, it would be really nice if the smarts match a lot of our visual intuitions and assumptions. And so how we do it at Reverie is that we basically have two classes of atoms. We have basically inflexible atoms and flexible atoms. And the inflexible atoms are the atoms that are generally fixed. They are what you see. And for those, we don't specify any labels. And for the flexible atoms, these are things that can have attached atoms, R groups, various things. And for those, we specify them with a label. And then what happens next? So here's an example of how I would write the reaction smarts. And so first, we identify the inflexible atoms. So here, the oxygens are inflexible because we want them to be what they are. And so they're very easy to write. The flexible atoms are basically the atoms that can carry different R groups. And we make sure we have two specific indices. And we can also add modifiers to the atoms as well. And then we see that, the final smarts is basically exactly what we intuitively think this reaction should be. So what happens next is that we post-process these smarts to make sure that these fixed atoms are exactly how we want. And we post-process them by adding them, connectivity restraints and ring restraints. And so this is an example of what the first smarts would be. So how does this actually happen? So for example, this reaction would get post-processed and reaction. Obviously, you don't want to write the second reaction manually by hand because very tedious. So how do we actually do this post-processing? Well, if you look at the Python APIs, there's adjust query parameters, and you can adjust ring constraints, degree constraints, but we just wanted to adjust the name. And there's no Python thing in that. But if you look at the C++ code, there is a flag to allow you to do that. But because all of our stack is in Python, we can't just use C++. But luckily, you can just set the appropriate flags. It could be what you want. And then it allows you to do this smart query adjustment automatically. So now that we have that, the rest of the get possible reactions is basically trying to see which of the product smarts match the compound, and then just filtering the list of reactions based on that. So our reaction, our retrosynthesis algorithm is mainly complete. And this is kind of an example application that we built to have different needs. So because we can do it using API, we can also make a simple web app. And so it's not too interactive but you can just input smiles and then it can show you the reaction pathways. And the green boxes are photo bots. So what are the pros and cons of this recognition algorithm? Well, for one pro, it's easier to write higher fidelity reactions. And the implementation is we basically looked at a bunch of commonly used reactions and just translated them into Sparks. They can be more customized. You can add your own metadata. You can add more reactions. You can remove reactions that you don't think are that useful. You can also add different search heuristics. So when you search through the different reactions, you can basically add a heuristic. And this could be either machine learning or it can be a much simpler heuristic as well. And we found that if you use a simple heuristic, you can actually speed up the runtimes of successfully found pathways by orders of magnitude. And of course, the whole point of this is that we can use this to filter large sets of compounds. For some of the cons, you still have to write the SMARTs, which is unfortunate. I don't want to write SMARTs that often, but luckily it's, you just have to write it once and then you're done. And then it's potentially slow. If a compound is not synthesizable, you have to look through all the reaction pathways and go through all the DFS. So it could be slow. And then, how useful really is our reaction? And what we found is that this tool wasn't being used that much. And why was going on? And the issue is that, in the drug discovery pipeline, there's hit finding, hit to lead, and lead off. And in hit finding, you can propose a bunch of compounds to try to synthesize and try to create, but usually, you're going for, some large library that, E Molecules has or Enamine has or, some vendor has, and just selecting the ones that, that you find. And then on the other spectrum, lead optimization, you already have a series. So you basically are trying to, adjust the tails and heads of different groups. And the reaction pathway is already pretty well defined and you're just substituting building blocks in. So you don't really need a retrospective algorithm there. And so that brings us to hit to lead. And this is kind of like the only case where, using a retrospective algorithm is useful because you have lots more diverse ideas and you're starting to build off of a weak inhibitor. But here, also enumeration techniques start to become useful as well as you start to change large groups. And so basically this allows us to think about how we use this in other different applications, such as reaction-based enumeration and bias. And for reaction-based enumeration, luckily, we our whole thing is making reaction sparks. So we can basically, if we're doing a enumeration on some core here, we can easily specify a bunch of building blocks that match these reaction sparks. And then we can basically enumerate a whole bunch of analogs. And because our post-process smarts allow us to only hit the things that we want, we have a much higher success rate in the analogs that we get. And then for bioassisted substitution, you can easily and don't have to writing the reactions is very simple. Okay. And with that, I'd like to thank my coworkers at Relabs. I actually have a coworker Waleed here, who was in Berlin continuing at this time. And he helped out with the brainstorming of the resistance algorithm. And I'd like to thank the RFK community, especially Greg, for helping the mailing list and answering questions for customers. Yeah.
Do we do have time for questions? Are there questions out there?
That's Ben. There's a microphone.
Thank you. I wonder if you could some of these people like Ari Pilot and Express Smart with Microphone, you can help them with Smart compared to you.
Sorry, it was RD Pyrrol.
Can you repeat the question?
Oh, yes. I think the question was, have you looked at RD Kit Chiral, and which can extract the smarts from the reactors? The answer is no, I've not heard of that. But I have seen some of the reactions extracted from, I think, like ASCOS or some of the open reaction data sets. And those reactions are pretty messy. I feel like usually when you think of reactions, you think of like a Suzuki reaction or some like AMI formation, but those are just like smarts and they're really hard to know exactly what's going on. I'm not sure if that answers your question. I haven't looked at RD.
Just as an FYI, RD Chiral is from Connor Foley, who's okay. At MIT, which is just down the street.
Yeah.
So
yeah. Okay.
Maybe it's easy to talk.
Yeah. Yeah.
Other questions?
How do you consider this for people?
Sorry, I didn't catch the.
How do you consider it from this build your existing?
Right, yeah. So the question was how do you consider the different possible reactions as you build your retro synthesis pathways and search? So I kind of alluded to that in the. Adjusting search heuristics. So if you do a naive, just like look at all possible reactions and go through them one by one, you can potentially go down bad reaction routes and then your runtime be very slow. So if you basically sort those reactions in a way that allows you to look at the most promising reactions first, then you can make it really fast. So I think our algorithm can find pathways in like less than like 1,000 compounds in a second. So.
Time for maybe one or two more questions.
Where do your reactions come from? Are people just writing them or writing? Yeah, are people that write in the slide?
Yeah, so these, the question was, where do these reactions come from? Are people just drawing them, et cetera? So, chemists don't really, write smarts. So a lot of these smarts I had to manually curate. There's one website that had a bunch of very good reaction smarts already. I forget the source on that. I can look it up if I need to. Otherwise, a lot of it has been going through the commonly used reactions in like organicchemistry.org or something. And as well as, if it couldn't find the synthetic pathway to some of our own compounds, then, think about which reactions are needed and then just putting them in. And because you don't have to like train up machine learning model every time, you can just like put them in and then, yeah, it just works.
So
the question was, can this retro synthesis algorithm take into account incompatible reactions or reactants. And the answer is no, it doesn't take into account that. On one side, you don't really need it to do that because, you know, we're not looking for a retrosynthesis algorithm that's 100% correct, right? We just need something that's mostly correct to allow us to filter out a bunch of compounds. And then in the end, you know, you're going to send these compounds to some vendor and they're going to say, can we make these or not? So you don't need it to be 100% correct. Can you adjust this algorithm to address what you're talking about? Potentially, I haven't really thought too much about it, but maybe you can add some sort of like metadata to it, some post-processing. I'm not entirely sure.
That's a deep topic.
Yeah.
Maybe leave that for the break.
Yeah.
I'd like to thank Hal for the presentation.